To thee we come, O Lord our God.
Today, as summer comes slowly to an end and we start anticipating the new school year in the fall, we celebrate Youth Sunday throughout our church. And special prayers during the Mass will be for our young people and also our youth programs. And so at the end of Mass, we'll accept a special collection for the youth fund of the church. And one of the things that that benefits is stuff like our retreat that just completed this Thursday. So as we do gather on this Youth Sunday today, I ask you at this time to please make a private examination of your conscience in preparation for Mass. And may we now recite the Confiteor that is found on page 41 together. I confess to Almighty God, one of the Holy Trinity, who knows the innermost secrets of my heart, that I have sinned in thought, word, and deed, by my fault, by my own great fault. In your presence, O God, I publicly express sorrow for the many sins by which I offended you. I resolve to amend my life, to improve and sanctify, endeavoring henceforth to serve you faithfully all the days of my life. I ask all those who dwell within the Church of Christ, the Blessed Mother Mary, the Holy Apostles, the Martyrs, the faithful, who have mercy on us, forgive our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
May the Almighty and merciful Lord grant us pardon, absolution, and remission of our sins.
Amen.
May our Lord Jesus Christ absolve you, and with his authority vested in me, I absolve you from all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Show us your mercy, Lord.
And grant
us your salvation. Lord, hear our prayer.
And let our cry
to you. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Grant, most gracious Father, that with purity of heart we may worthily fulfill this holy action established in remembrance of the Last Supper and the death of Jesus Christ, and for our sanctification and salvation. Be present among us, Jesus, our most perfect Master, because you said that where two or three are gathered together in my name, you are among them. We also ask, Lord, that through this holy liturgy we may experience a spiritual revival and better understanding of your holy will, bringing us together in one great family, guided by your commandments and by love, truth, and justice.
Amen.
And may we now say together, let us praise the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, indivisible, revealed in triune power for all time, now and forever.
Glory to God in the highest,
Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and eternal God, keep in your tender care the young people of our Holy Church, that they may understand those things that are in harmony with your holy will. Create in them a spirit of true happiness in your service, that they may become followers of your holy word, now and in the days to come. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
The lesson prescribed by the Church for this morning's Holy Mass is taken from the New Testament book of the Epistle to the Hebrews. You have not come to something that can be touched, a blazing fire and darkness and gloom, and a tempest, and the sound of a trumpet, and a voice whose words made the heavens beg, hearers beg, that not another word be spoken to them, for they could not endure the order that was given. If even an animal touches the mountain, it shall be stoned to death. Indeed, so terrifying was the sight that Moses said, I tremble with fear. But you have come to Mount Zion, and to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, to the innumerable angels and festal gathering, to the assembly of the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of the righteous made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speaks a better word than the blood of Abel. This is the word of the Lord.
Amen.
Child, when you come to the service of God, stand in justice and fear to prepare your soul for temptation.
Humble your heart and the Lord.
Listen and
receive the word of understanding.
Alleluia, alleluia.
Alleluia, alleluia.
Therefore, my beloved, steadfast, immovable, always excelling in the work of the Lord, because you know that in the Lord your labor is not in vain.
Hallelujah.
Cleanse my heart and my lips, Almighty God, as you cleanse the lips of the prophet Isaiah with a burning coal. In your mercy, cleanse me so I may worthily proclaim your holy gospel through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Lord be in my heart and on my lips, that I may worthily proclaim his holy gospel. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Amen.
went to dine at the home of one of the leading Pharisees, and the people were there, and they were observing him closely. And he told a parable to those who had been invited, noticing how they were all choosing places of honor at the table. When you are invited by someone to a wedding banquet, do not recline at table in the place of honor. A more distinguished guest than you may have been invited by him, and the host who invited both of you will approach and say, "Give your place to this one." And then you would proceed with embarrassment to take the lowest place. Rather, when you are invited, go and take the lowest place, so that when the host comes, he may say, "My friend, move up to a higher position." And then you will enjoy the esteem of your companions at the table. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted. And then he said to the host who invited him, "When you hold a lunch or a dinner, do not invite your friends or your brothers or your relatives or your wealthy neighbors, in case they may invite you back and you have your repayment. Rather, when you hold a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind. Blessed indeed will you be because of their inability to repay you. For you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous." This is the gospel of the Lord. So the youth retreat, as I said, was Sunday. They completed on Thursday. And I don't know all about these apps, you know, but I guess there's an app that you can program in for a countdown. And every year, I think I told you the same thing last year, there are kids who have now got a countdown clock to August 20th. I forgot what the date was. It's whatever that Sunday is when we usually have our barbecue. They've already got a countdown clock going for that. And Mary was very nice. You know, Mary's the other chaperone there for us from Holy Name of Jesus. And as I'm singing and I'm happy on Thursday, Mary yells over to me, "Father, 360 days to camp." And I just went, boom. But Mary seems to do very well at camp. She seems to enjoy herself out there. And I give her credit. That's wonderful. But, you know, out there, there's this Camp Howe is deep in the DAR. And you got to go down this access road to get there. And all these other kids have got that countdown clock, you know, waiting until next year. There's something like the twilight zone for me. When I make that turn and I start heading deeper and deeper into the woods, it's like I never left. It's like I'm always there in the woods, and I'll always be there in the woods. And it's just the deeper I go, the darker it gets, and I kind of slink down farther and farther in my car. My classical music on 88.5 starts to fade away, and all of a sudden you see all of these kids running around and having a good time and being loud, and it's dirty. I don't know how they enjoy it so much. But anyway, it's not about me. You know, it's not that I like it, it's that the kids like it, and they really, really do. We had two first-time campers, like I said. Allie went for one day last year, and now she went for the whole week. And because she spoke so highly about it, her buddy Cammy went as well. And Cammy's mom, Ann back there, she had gone many times to the retreat. And, you know, it's kind of weird to say, because I'm only 30, but I was Ann's chaperone. Now somehow I'm her daughter's chaperone, and that's something to do, again, about that Twilight Zone stuff. So anyway, they're two first-time campers, and I've been up there a number of times to know that first-time campers, sometimes that first night can be a little rough. And we used to have like a fun, you know, happy movie. Last year's movie was that one with the nuns all dancing and everything, Sister Act or something like that, you know, kind of uplifting one. Well, this year's movie was uplifting. It was about a miracle. But to get to the miracle at the very end of the movie, you had to go through about an hour and a half of a really sad story about this girl who was dying. And I guess it's based on a true story. So I'm off to the side, and Allie is down in the front row right by Cammy here, and Allie, pretty sensitive girl, you know, it was starting to get a little bit rough on her. So instead of watching the movie, Allie and I went out onto the porch in the rain. There's a little bit of an overhang. We watched spiders making a web instead. And I'm thinking to myself, it's raining, it's dark, it's her first day away from home, and now she's scared. I'm in for a long night. Never saw the girl again. Never. She had no problems at all. Cammy here. Here's another problem I'm thinking about. Cammy on Tuesday turned 9 years old, and she spent her birthday up at the camp. And I'm thinking, okay, mom and dad and sister come up. They brought a cake and everything else. Sometimes first-time campers, they see mom and dad and, you know, sister. They want to get back in the car. They've had enough. They want to go home. So EJ says to her, "You want to go with us down to the ice cream?" "No, I want to go with you. I want to go with the Father Randy and the other girls." And so poor EJ, just like I would kind of just melted a little bit. But she did go, and they went with Allison down. And so I'm thinking between, you know, the rain that first led, the sad movie, Candy having her parents come up on her birthday. Like I said, these two girls right here, no problem at all. Nothing seemed to faze them. I even saw Candy at the YMSR picnic on Friday night over at the Zara's house. And I said, "Cammy, you miss me? We had all of our meals together for 4 days." "No, Father." No, Father, no problem at all. So anyway, these young girls very much impressed me. There's a lot of young kids that have a tough time at camp, but not these two. And if you get the electronic email from the camp, I ate all of my meals with these two girls, and I do that because I'm sly. You sit at the chaperones table with Father Rob, the Zeras, the Zodics, and all that. You know, you gotta like take a knife and you gotta grab your food first, or else it's gone. You sit with the young kids, and you know, you got as much food as you want. But you know the size of these two girls. You should see what they can put down for food. But even so, in that electronic email there that you saw, I think I mailed it out on Friday from Father Rob, I did not eat 30 corn dogs. Right? I liked them, but I didn't eat 30 of them. So anyway, Monday is the first day. I'm the first session. You know, the way they say it is they like to start with the best. And so I was the first session. So my session was about God's creation. We tied that in then with an activity by Mr. Bill Girardi over there, who was a teacher, now retired from Frontier. But before that, he was one of these conservation guys with the trustees of the reservation. And so Bill Girardi took us out on a nature hike, and he had a little bit of trouble getting into camp because just before he got there, they finally cleared a tree. That storm, I don't know how bad it was here, it was real bad up in Goshen, and it knocked the tree across the access road. So he couldn't get in, but we couldn't get out either. So anyway, they finally cleared that out, and then Bill was able to come up. And have you ever heard that proverb about does a bear poop in the woods? Well, Mr. Girardi showed us. Bears poop in the woods. And I mean bears poop in the woods. So that was like the highlight of the walk. You know, he's showing us all these beautiful trees and flowers and the way nature grows. The kids, for the rest of the week, talked about the bear poop in the woods. So on Tuesday, we go out for ice cream. And our fraternal pays for the ice cream outing. And we go down to Williamsburg. There's a real nice little store there. God forbid if you're taking the kids out for a little snack, you know, there's usually a line of maybe four or five people, and then, you know, 50 people show up, and so if you come right after we do, you're at the back of like some 50 people, but, you know, Spoonie dropped about, I would say, close to $300, and so we do appreciate that. And so on the way back, the Red Sox are on, and I mean, I haven't heard it, I haven't seen any newspaper, no nothing, I'm trying to listen to the Red Sox. These two girls, and then two girls from Westfield, they're singing to me almost the whole movie, something called Frozen. I cannot, and let's see, I've been, since 1985 or 1986, I've been, wait a minute, no, before that, 1983. Since 1983, I've been teaching catechism. I had the hardest time getting kids to remember the smallest one sentence. You know where I'm going. One sentence catechism answer. I cannot get them to memorize that. These girls sang to me every single line of every song in Frozen like they were part of the movie itself. And I'm trying to listen to the Red Sox and they're singing Frozen to me instead. Now Wednesday comes and we're going up to the mountain coaster. And I don't know if you know what the mountain coaster is. It's up at Berkshire East. And you come flying down the mountain in these open carts. Now, when we go up there, the first kid that I go with is Zachary. And Zachary's a cool kid from Central Falls. And here's another one of those Twilight Zone stories. I knew his mother as her chaperone way back, and now he's up there. And so I heard the mother come over to Zachary and say, Zach, when we go back home, you've got to get your physical to play basketball. So I hear that, and I say, Zach, you know, that physical means you got to get your appendix out to play basketball. What do you mean, Father? I said, you got to get that appendix out. It makes you move easier and you can go faster and all that kind of stuff. And so he goes over to his mother. I have to have my appendix out. You don't have to have your appendix out, Zachary. Who told you that? And he points to me like this. So Zachary is going to get back at me. And so he's my first ride on the mountain coaster. So he's in the front, I'm in the back, and you can go as slow as you want by pushing the brakes or just letting it go and flying. And he wants me to be scared because, well, they say I scream like a little girl. And so I'm going up there, all set, and then Zachary is all set to scare me, but we are two cars behind Boo. Who's the slow one?
Father Senior Joe.
So Father Senior Joe is not a small man. Father Senior Joe takes up the entire cart, and he's going up the hill, and we're two cars back. So it's Father Senior Joe, Bishop all by himself, because he's not a small man, and then me and Zach. And so as we're coming up, we see Father Joe just starting to go down. And I, you know, I'm not real brave with this, but Father Joe is coming down, and as soon as he starts to go down, the brakes come on. And so the whole way down, Father Joe is going like at a walking pace down this entire mountain. So the bishop is behind him, and the bishop has no fear. He wants to go fast. And the cars have some automatic brakes. If you get within 80 feet of the guy in front of you, the person in front of you, you slam on a brake. And the bishop is complaining at retreat about his back. So the bishop has got a bad back. Father Joe is going down, like I said, at this really slow pace, and you can see he's grabbing out like that. The bishop gets that 80-foot point and just stops immediately like that. And you can see the bishop going like this, throws his back up. I am one car behind all of this mess, and so the same thing happens to us, because when the bishop goes like that, well, Zach and I go like that, so we can't go very fast. But what was terrifying is that when we stop automatically, we're in the middle of a bank corner. So Zach and I, in our car, we're like this, hanging, and we can't move. And so you're strapped in, thank God for the strap, because we're literally hanging like this in that car, praying for Father Joe to get moving, because this is not fun. You look down, and there's nothing but rocks below you. And so Zach didn't get to go very fast, but they scared the bejesus out of me anyway. So my second ride was this very cute little girl from Westfield, Peyton. And Peyton is another very nice girl from Westfield's friend. And last year, you may remember, Melanie was the one that made me scream like a little girl. But every time I tried to put on the brakes, she just kept pushing my hands forward and going faster. So I said, I'm not going with you anymore, Melanie. So Peyton, her friend, says, I'll go with you, Father. I'm not at all like Melanie. And I said, oh, Peyton, thank you. I'll go with you. So the whole way up, we're just having a nice conversation. We're looking at the different stuff and all of that. And you know, Peyton's nice and sweet. As soon as we hit the downhill, she does the exact same thing. She lied to me. She lied to me. She's pushing my hand down. And then, you know, well, I'm a little bit stronger than a little girl. But she takes her elbow and she's putting it into my rib cage. So I'm going down this thing with Peyton, like I said, screaming like a little girl, and Peyton said, "No, no, Father, I'm not at all like Melanie. I won't do that to you. I want to go slow." So anyway, I did end up screaming like a little girl on the way down, because it was a Jekyll and Hyde story. And now, you may have noticed, I got a lot of stories about these two, because I spent a lot of time with these two. I already mentioned Mary. I have nothing to say about Aaron. And you know why? And even in the sacristy, I said, "Aaron, you look a little bit different. What's the matter with you? Aaron, there's something that's just different about you." And I said, "Oh, that's right. No boyfriend blew right to her side. Aaron, our little Aaron, my acolyte, is in love." So I never saw Aaron, because Aaron was always, if you found one, you found the other. And now they're, if you saw the electronic email, you saw with flashlights what they can do in time-lapse photography, and they made that cool sign that said reverence. Well, out in the middle of the field, under the stars, it was so beautiful. Aaron and her boyfriend are holding, and they made this beautiful heart around them. And as I told both her and her boyfriend throughout the week, young love makes me sick to my stomach. I couldn't stand it. I just get this warm water that comes up to here every time you're making goo-goo eyes at each other. So that's the only star I got about Aaron, because, well, to tell you the truth, Erin wasn't all signed up for the retreat until she went to Congo and fell in love. And then all of a sudden she said, "Oh, I want to go to the retreat too, Father." I said, "Oh, yeah, there's somebody else who's got their religious book." "No, I'm in love." So that's it. No more about Erin. Erin, that's all. So you got all of that. And like I said, it's 360 more days until camp. And what I would love to do is every year I come back, I tell you these stories. You know, there aren't a lot of kids back in here yet, and I'm hoping they're going to be back in September, but we got to do more to get more kids up there. This is a great program, and, you know, kids, I know by the end of summer, are getting bored. These kids have a great time up there, and it's good for them to be away from moms and dads. It really is healthy. And even if they get a little bit scared, even if the food isn't as good as mom puts out, even if there's no soft couch to sit on all the time, get them out in the woods. You know, I complain. I'm telling you, this is a good program for kids. And I hope next year, instead of five of us, we can have 10, or maybe like we used to have, do like 12 and 13, because this is a good program. And I hope and I pray that next year you remember all of this stuff now, and we won't have so hard a time to get a few more souls out there with us. And then the last thing I want to say, since it is Youth Sunday, later on today, maybe right after Mass, I'm going to send out the SOCL letters we always do on this Youth Sunday. And the SOCL letter is about, you know, the beginning of our program. And Jesus's, the gospel today was that Jesus went to the house of the Pharisee, and they didn't so much listen to what he had to say, they watched what he did. And ours is a school of Christian living. It's about how we train our kids, not train, how we teach and inspire our kids to live. Catechism is where you learn the fundamentals. You know, you learn all of the stuff that you need to know is basic for being a Christian. But school of Christian living is how you live as a Christian. Because people are going to watch how we live. That's your best message. That's your best proclamation. Do we act any different because we've come here on a Sunday? And that doesn't happen like that. It happens because young people, like Jesus, you know, are learning about how to live as Christians. So that letter goes out this afternoon, or even maybe this morning, and we hope and we pray that our young families will take Christian education seriously. We never ask a penny for any of the materials. We've got four great volunteers that give of their Sunday, Sunday after Sunday after Sunday. They never ask for anything in return. And we got all of this, but what we need is the parents and the kids' support as well, so that we don't have just maybe 30% of the kids showing up on any given Sunday. We've got to try to make Sunday a priority again, including School of Christian Living, because people watch to see if this makes a difference. So on this Youth Sunday, for all the prayers that we have, the programs that we have, the money that we'll ask for at the end of Mass, please keep these young people in your thoughts and in your prayers, because being young today, with all of that electronic access, they can have, anybody can have access to them at almost any time. You know, you could once as a parent, you know, watch where your kids were going, make sure they were safe. Now stuff can happen, you know, right in your bedroom, right in your living room, you'll never know. And we have to offer them the safety of this faith community. And for these things, this Youth Sunday, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty Lord, as we gather before your altar on this last Sunday of August, we offer our special prayers for Uncle Charles Murray, who died on his birthday, August 20th, 2016, as offered by Kathy LaFleur. We offer prayers for Katrina, a daughter of a friend, for a speedy recovery from back surgery that she had on Saturday, as offered by Linda Pahalski. We also offer prayers for Liz Richmond, recently diagnosed with cancer, who is raising three young girls on her own, as offered by Cindy Benjamin. We also offer prayers for those battling cancer, Meg Connors by Ellen and Don Strosky, Randy Clements by grandmother Dottie Baronis, Carl Dickinson by Joe and Peg Kuster, fathers Ray Trader, Jan Vilcek, and Maurice Lazelle, as offered by myself. Richard Poe is offered by the Poe and Foster families. Two-year-old Jack Sella is offered by Marianne Foster. And also Frank Sprosky, the twin brother of Don, is offered by the Sprosky, Gates, and Kirkendall families. Are there any other intentions? Ellen?
A man, his name is Dan, and he's waiting for heart transplant.
Dan waiting for heart transplant. You want to say anything else about a Don?
This was John's roommate. I mean, John just had another stent put in this week, and his roommate is someone waiting for heart transplant.
Okay. Ellen is being very coy, but after the barbecue and everything, Don was waiting for a second carotid artery, right? Surgery to be done out in Boston, and an opening showed up on the calendar, and so they gave them a call, and Don went out to Boston this week with 1 day's notice, had the operation, everything was successful, really good news for Don, and he is back home recovering now, so we're really happy to hear about that. Did you have something, Kathy?
Yes,
a
prayer for strength and healing for Stephanie Peace, who has aggressive brain cancer.
Stephanie?
Peace is the last name. She has aggressive.
Sorry to hear. Okay, for Stephanie Peace. Okay. Any other prayers, intentions? For all of these prayers, Lord, including the private ones that we now bring before your altar, and also, Lord, we ask you to bless each and every one of us here gathered. Also, bless those for our parish who are unable to be with us here today, and those for our parish who have chosen not to be with us here today. And for these things together, Lord, we pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord. May he rest in peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, but one being of the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered death in his spirit. On the third day he rose again in fulfillment of the scriptures. He ascended.
with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. The Lord is the eternal God, the creator of all the earth. He gives strength to the weak, to the fainting he makes vigor abound. Through the young faint and grow weary, and the youth stagger and fall, that they hope in the Lord will renew in their strength, and they will soar with eagle's wings.
Darkness and
into your own wonderful light. Therefore, the angels and archangels, with all the saints and the entire church, we lift our hymn of praise to your glory, repeating unceasingly.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
We therefore, most merciful Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, most humbly beseech you to accept and to bless these gifts, these presents, these holy, unspotted sacrifices, which your holy church receives from you, in point you to defend and guide her throughout the world, together with her priests and all true believers in the holy faith. Remember, Lord, your servant. All present in this congregation, imbued with faith in your holy care, your rule, and fatherly love, wholeheartedly this day, united in spirit with all of those, beginning with the most blessed Mary, Mother of Jesus Christ, likewise with apostles, with all the countless hosts of martyrs and confessors who lived, labored, and suffered for the same holy cause which Jesus Christ sacrificed his life in his most precious blood, just as they believed, professed, and united with you through prayer and some act of oblation, which you have instituted from the beginning of the world in time and fulfilled through Jesus Christ, and gave it to humanity as a pledge of eternal salvation. So we too this day profess and unite ourselves with you, most gracious Father, in humbleness of spirit, and accept from your hands this holy bread and this precious chalice as a longed-for gift bestowed on us by the Savior of the world as spiritual food and drink. He promised us this food and drink in that moment when he revealed his divine power by the multiplication of bread and feeding with it a hungry multitude of people. Afterward, he foretold the giving of that food and drink to his disciples and friends as a more excellent nourishment when he said, "It is my Father who gives you the heavenly bread. I myself am the living bread come down from heaven. If anyone eats this bread, he shall live forever. The bread I will give is my flesh for the life of the world." And afterwards, with the temporal and messianic life of the divine teacher and year of the covenant was drawing to a close, he gathered into the upper room all those who had loved in a singular way and had chosen to continue his work of salvation. He spoke to them words of deep love, longing, and resolve. "I will not leave you orphaned. I will come back to you. I am the way, the truth, and the life. You are my friends if you do what I command you. Do not be distressed or fearful. You will suffer in the world, but take courage. I have overcome the world. If you live in me and my words stay a part of you, you may ask what you will, and it will be done for you. Anyone who loves me will be true to my word, and my Father will love him. We will come to him and make our dwelling place with him. I consecrate myself for their sakes now, that they may be consecrated in truth, that all may be one as you, Father, are in me and I in you. I pray that they may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. I have given them the glory you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I living in them, you living in me, that their unity may be made complete. Father, all those you gave me, I would have in my company where I am, to see this glory of mine, which is your gift to me, because of the love you bore me before the world began. I myself am the bread of life. No one who comes to me will ever be hungry. No one who believes in me shall ever thirst. After these and other words of the archpriest in prayer and with holy fervor, our Savior took bread into his holy and venerable hand, and having lifted his eyes to heaven, to you, his almighty Father, giving thanks to you, he blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which is given for you." In like manner, after supper, taking this excellent chalice into his holy and venerable hands, again he gave thanks to you, blessed it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, which shall be shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me." Wherefore, mindful, Lord, we your servants, as also your faithful people, remembrance of this Christ, your Son and our Lord, as well as his blessed passion, resurrection, and his glorious ascension, we receive from your own gifts and presents a pure offering, a holy offering, an immaculate offering, the holy bread of eternal life, the chalice of eternal salvation. These gifts we receive with a joyful countenance as from him, who is the giver of all temporal and eternal good gifts, and with an unshakable faith that they will become for our souls a saving remedy. We humbly ask, O Almighty God, to command that our offering be brought by the hands of your holy angel to your highest altar, into the presence of your divine majesty. That we who receive the most sacred body and blood of your Son at this altar may be filled with every blessing and grace through Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and who have passed on to eternity. These souls, Lord, and all who rest in Christ, grant everlasting life, and to those that are in life's grade from the path of righteousness, unmindful of your fatherly love, mercifully shorten their sufferings. We ask this in the name of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And grant us, your sinful servants, who hope in the greatness of your mercy, some part in the fellowship of your holy apostles and martyrs, and all your saints, who shed their blood for your name. Their hearts are always open to justice and mercy, and with lives patterned after their divine master, merited eternal joy. Number us in their company, Lord, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom you always create, sanctify, revive, bless, and freely give us all these good things. Through him, and with him, and in him, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. Forever and ever. Let us pray, instructed by our Savior's teaching and following divine example, we say with confidence. Grant us the peace and unity of your kingdom, for you live and reign forever and ever. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, by the will of the Father, the work of the Holy Spirit, your death brought life to the world. By your holy body and blood, free me from all my sins and from every evil. Keep me faithful to your teaching, and never let me be parted from you, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. May the partaking of your body and blood, Lord Jesus, not be caused for my judgment. Though I am unworthy to receive this great sacrament, through your loving kindness may become my safeguard and healing remedy. My saving master, awaken to me a living faith, fervent love, worship, adoration, and a holy longing. Through this communion, make me your willing servant, zealous to fulfill your holy will. May it last and I be tiny with you, my Lord and my God. Grant this who lives, reigns with God the Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen. I will take the bread of heaven, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. May the body of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to everlasting life. Amen. But shall I return to the Lord for all the graces that he has given me? I will take the chalice of salvation, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. With high praise will I call upon the Lord, I shall be saved from all my iniquities. May the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to life everlasting. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Lord, I am not worthy. You should enter into my heart, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Lord, I am not worthy. You should enter into my heart, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Lord, I am not worthy. You should enter into my heart, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
The body and the blood of Christ.
body and the blood of Christ. The 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 body and the blood of Christ.
Church, may your spirit guide the youth of every generation to
work diligently for the glory of your holy name. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Grant that the sacrifice which I, though unworthy, have offered in the sight of your majesty be acceptable to you, that your mercy may be effective for myself and all of those for whom I have offered it, through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Almighty God bless you. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.